Okay, so get this ivermectin right. It won a Nobel Prize back in 2015 for being like incredible at fighting parasites.
Right.
But get this, researchers are looking into something even crazier, using it to treat cancer.
Wow.
We're talking cutting edge stuff, so just so you know, we're exploring possibilities, not giving medical advice or anything like that.
Of course.
Today, we're diving deep into this blog post from Medicate. It's called Ivermectin, From Fighting Parasites to Battling Cancer.
Okay.
It was published just last month, February 9th, 2025, and we're going to be looking at the research that it links to as well.
Sounds good.
So our mission today is to understand how ivermectin might work against cancer.
Okay.
What kinds of cancer are showing promise and what the research is saying so far.
Got it.
So, I mean, it's pretty wild, right? This drug that's known for fighting like river blindness.
Right.
And now it's potentially tackling cancer.
It's definitely an unexpected turn, you know, to see it potentially tackling something as complex as cancer.
Yeah.
It's fascinating.
So what is it about this parasite fighting drug that suddenly got scientists buzzing about cancer?
Well, it all starts with ivermectin's unique chemical structure. It's actually made up of two compounds.
Oh, wow.
And it's got this ring-like shape that helps it move around the body really effectively.
Uh-huh.
Plus, it's considered very safe at the doses typically used for those parasitic infections.
So it's like this little ninja
slipping
in and out of places other drugs can't reach.
That's a great way to put it. And what's really remarkable is that it doesn't just attack cancer cells in one way.
Okay.
It's got a multi-pronged approach.
Oh, okay. All ears. Break it down for me.
First, it can actually stop those cells from growing by blocking the signals that tell them to multiply.
Right.
It's like hitting the pause button on their uncontrolled growth. And then it can prevent the cancer from spreading by messing with the mechanisms those cells use to travel to other parts of the body.
Gotcha.
And finally, get this. It can actually cut off the blood supply to the tumors. Yeah, we call this angiogenesis.
Wow.
And it's essentially, it's like cutting off the supply lines to a city, essentially starving the tumor.
That's pretty intense.
It is.
Can you tell me a bit more about how that works?
So imagine a tumor is like a rapidly growing city.
Okay.
It needs a constant supply of resources, like oxygen and nutrients, to survive and expand, right?
Yeah.
These resources are delivered through blood vessels, which act like the city's roads and highways. And ivermectin basically comes in and sets up roadblocks, preventing those vital supplies from reaching the tumor.
That's so cool. So it's not just about directly killing the cancer cells.
Right.
It's about cutting off their lifeline.
Exactly.
That's a pretty clever strategy.
It is. And to make things even more interesting, ivermectin seems to have a particular affinity for this enzyme called PAK1 kinase.
Hold on.
Yeah.
PAK1 kinase.
Yeah.
What is that?
This enzyme is like a master switch for a bunch of processes in cancer cells, including growth, survival, and even how they move and spread.
Okay, master switch. That sounds important.
Yeah.
What exactly does it control?
Think of it as like a central command center. It regulates things like cell growth, movement, and even the way cells respond to signals from their environment. So by targeting PK1 kinase, ivermectin can like throw a wrench into these crucial processes, essentially disrupting the cancer cell's entire operation.
So disrupting the bad guy's plans.
Yeah.
Check. But ultimately, we want those cells gone, right?
Right.
Does ivermectin actually kill them?
That's where things get really wild. So you see, ivermectin can actually trigger what we call programmed cell death.
Okay.
It can do this in a few different ways.
Oh, this is fascinating. Tell me more about these different death pathways.
Sure. So the first one is called apoptosis, which is like the normal, organized way cells die off.
Right.
It's like a pre-programmed self-destruct sequence built into the cell. And then there's autophagy, where the cell essentially starts to break down and consume its own components.
Wait, so the cells can like eat themselves?
Yeah, they can.
That's both bizarre and kind of amazing.
Nature is full of surprises.
Yeah, it really is.
And finally, there's pyroptosis, which is a much more fiery death.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, triggers inflammation, which can actually alert the immune system to the presence of a threat.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
So it's like they go out with a bang.
They do.
Like some of their buddies with them.
Yeah.
That's pretty impressive.
It definitely shows the diverse ways ivermectin can affect these cells. And the fact that it can trigger these death pathways in cancer cells.
Yeah.
It's one of the things that makes it so promising as a potential treatment.
So it sounds like ivermectin is a bit of a multi-talented assassin when it comes to cancer cells.
You could say that.
But is this like a one-size-fits-all solution? Does it work on all types of cancer?
Well, that's where things get really exciting for you. Research has shown that ivermectin has some level of effectiveness against a surprisingly diverse range of cancers. We're talking breast cancer, digestive system cancers like colorectal and gastric cancers.
Wow.
Even urinary system cancers like bladder cancer.
That's quite a list.
Yeah.
Are there any specific types of cancer where the research is, like, particularly promising, something you think our listener might want to hear more about?
Well, since we know this deep dive is specifically for you,
yeah,
let's focus on what's relevant to your situation.
Okay, sounds good.
But broadly speaking, there's definitely a lot of buzz around ivermectin's potential in treating cancers that are notoriously difficult to manage.
So it's not just about treating any cancer.
Right.
It's about potentially offering new hope,
yeah,
for those really tough cases.
Exactly.
That's incredible. But before we get ahead of ourselves, I know there's a lot more to this story, right?
There is.
What are some of the challenges researchers are facing when it comes to actually using ivermectin to treat cancer?
That's a great question. You see, it's not just about what ivermectin can do.
Mm-hmm.
It's about making sure it gets to where it needs to go in the body. Think of it like this. We have this powerful weapon,
okay,
but we need to make sure it hits the right target.
I see where you're going with this.
Hmm.
So what are the hurdles when it comes to delivering ivermectin effectively to those cancer cells?
Well, traditional methods like pills or injections have limitations.
Right.
Pills, for example, often have low bioavailability.
Okay.
Which basically means the body doesn't absorb all of the drug. And injections, while more direct, can have potential side effects, especially when you need to use higher doses.
Right. So just popping a pill or getting a shot might not be the most effective way to deliver this powerful weapon.
Exactly.
What are researchers doing to overcome these delivery challenges?
That's where things get really futuristic. Scientists are working on some incredibly innovative delivery systems using things like nanoparticles, liposomes, and even polymer carriers.
Nanoparticles attacking cancer cells. That sounds like something straight out of a sci-fi movie.
It really is cutting-edge stuff, and it gets even cooler.
Okay.
Researchers are even developing what we call smart nanocarriers. These can actually sense the tumor environment and release the drug exactly where it's needed most.
Whoa. So it's like giving ivermectin a GPS system?
Exactly.
To navigate directly to the cancer cell.
You got it.
That's amazing. This is like seriously mind-blowing technology.
It really is a testament to how far we've come in terms of combining biology and nanotechnology to fight diseases like cancer.
Yeah.
And it's this kind of innovation that's driving the excitement around ivermectin's potential.
But let's be realistic here.
Okay.
I know this research is still in its early stages.
It is.
We can't get ahead of ourselves and assume this is like a guaranteed cure for cancer.
You're absolutely right. We still have a lot to learn about how ivermectin works against cancer.
Yeah.
And more importantly, how to use it safely and effectively in humans.
So what are some of the biggest unknowns right now? What are scientists still trying to figure out?
Well, one of the most important unknowns is the dosage.
Okay.
We know the doses used for parasitic infections.
Yeah.
But those are likely very different from what we'd need to effectively treat cancer.
Okay. So it's like adjusting a recipe, finding the right balance of ingredients to get the desired outcome.
Exactly. And we also need to figure out how to best combine ivermectin with other cancer therapies. You know, could it boost the effectiveness of chemo or radiation?
Right.
Could it help reduce side effects? These are all questions that need to be answered through carefully designed clinical trials.
Speaking of clinical trials, those are essential, right?
Oh, absolutely.
They're how we go from, like, promising lab results to real-world treatments that can actually help people.
They are the gold standard for determining the safety and effectiveness of any new treatment.
Yeah.
Especially when dealing with a complex disease like cancer.
Just to be clear for our listener, we need to remember that while ivermectin shows a lot of promise, it's not a miracle cure.
Right.
We also need to be aware of the potential for side effects.
Of course.
Especially at higher doses than those used for parasitic infections.
That's a crucial point. It's important to approach any new treatment with a healthy dose of cautious optimism.
Yeah.
And to always consult with a qualified healthcare professional to make informed decisions about your health.
Couldn't agree more. This has been a fascinating deep dive so far.
Yeah, it has.
We've gone from parasites to cancer.
We have.
Explored cellular death pathways,
mm-hmm.
and even touched on futuristic nanotechnology. And the best part is, we're just getting started.
I know, right?
So how did this whole COVID-19 controversy affect the perception of ivermectin as a potential cancer treatment? Did it kind of get lumped in with all the misinformation and, like, dismissed?
It definitely had an impact. The controversy surrounding ivermectin's use for COVID-19 created this, like, shadow of doubt that unfortunately obscured the legitimate research being conducted on its anti-cancer properties. However, it's important to remember that the scientific community doesn't operate solely based on public opinion or media trends.
Okay.
So, while the controversy may have created some challenges, researchers continued to investigate ivermectin's potential in cancer treatment.
Okay.
And we're now seeing a growing body of evidence supporting its effectiveness.
That's reassuring to hear.
Yeah.
So despite the noise and distractions, the science marched on.
It did.
What are some of the most exciting developments happening now, things our listeners should keep an eye on?
Well, one area that's generating a lot of buzz is the idea of personalized medicine. Remember those smart nanocarriers we talked about earlier?
Yeah.
Imagine combining those with genetic testing to create truly individualized cancer treatments.
Okay, now that sounds incredible. You're talking about tailoring ivermectin delivery to each person's unique genetic makeup.
Precisely. By analyzing a patient's genes, doctors could pinpoint specific mutations or characteristics of their cancer cells.
Mm-hmm.
And that information could then be used to design nanocarriers that deliver ivermectin directly to those cells, maximizing its impact and minimizing side effects.
That's amazing. It's like a guided missile with a personalized address label, delivering the treatment right where it needs to go.
It's a truly remarkable convergence of technology and medicine.
Yeah.
And this personalized approach could revolutionize how we treat cancer. Imagine a future where therapies are customized.
Wow.
To each individual's needs, increasing their chances of success and improving their overall quality of life.
That's definitely a future worth striving for. But I'm also curious about the timeline.
Sure.
When might we realistically see these advanced ivermectin therapies becoming available to patients?
It's tough to pinpoint an exact timeline because, you know, drug development is a complex process with multiple stages, including extensive clinical trials.
Yeah.
But with the increasing research and the rapid advancements in drug delivery technology, I'm cautiously optimistic that we could see significant progress within the next decade.
So maybe not tomorrow.
Right.
But definitely something to be hopeful for in the foreseeable future.
Absolutely.
It's exciting to think about the possibilities.
It is.
And breakthroughs often happen unexpectedly.
That's true.
A new discovery or a technological innovation could accelerate the timeline significantly.
We've certainly done our part today by shedding light on ivermectin.
We have.
So as we wrap up this fascinating deep dive, I want to leave our listener with one final thought to ponder.
Okay.
Imagine a future where ivermectin, this once humble parasite fighter, becomes this commonplace tool in the fight against cancer.
Wow.
A future where those personalized targeted treatments become a reality. Is it a pipe dream, or could this be the future of cancer care? The answer, my friend, lies in the continued pursuit of knowledge, rigorous scientific research, and, you know, a healthy dose of curiosity. Keep exploring, keep asking questions, and who knows, maybe you'll be a part of making that future a reality. Until next time, stay curious and keep diving deep into the world of knowledge and discovery.